AP 120, Chapter 6, Topics, Epidermis, Dermis, and Subcutaneous Layer. All right, we're moving on to the Integumentary System, the first of our body systems. Integumentary system is made up of the skin, which is the largest organ of the body. It also happens to be known as the integument, although I'm going to call the skin the skin. Then underneath the skin, or deep to the skin, is the subcutaneous layer. This layer is made up mostly of adipose tissue. And of course, there are various accessory structures associated with this system, such as hair, nails, sweat glands, oil glands, things like that. Here is an image of a cadaver with the skin in place. Here is the image of a cadaver with the skin removed so that you can see the subcutaneous layer underneath. One thing you might notice is the nipples are clearly part of the skin because they are removed when you remove the skin. Functions of the skin. One important function is thermoregulation. The skin helps to allow us to control our overall body temperature. We'll talk more about that later. Another function is protection. Skin is very important for protecting underlying tissues. The skin prevents damage via abrasions from deeper tissues, from concussive interactions, from chemicals, from sunlight, lots of things the skin helps to protect from. The skin also helps to slow down water loss. We always lose some water from the skin, but it is less than it could be. The skin houses many sensory receptors to allow us to detect things like the overall temperature of something we're reaching out to touch, the sensation of touch, itch, tickle, lots of things like that. The skin is a way for us to get rid of materials or excrete materials through secretion, again, sweat glands, oil glands, that sort of thing. And the skin is involved in the synthesis of vitamin D. A very early precursor of vitamin D arrives through the skin and its exposure to UV light that then allows it to be altered and sent on through the process of making vitamin D. All right, here is a lovely cartoon view of the skin and subcutaneous layer. So at the top, we have the epidermis, which is the upper or superficial region of the skin. Then below that, we have the thicker dermis, where we see lots of structures embedded. And then deep to that is the subcutaneous layer. So what is the primary tissue for the epidermis? Well, I hope you remember from chapter 4 that it is the stratified squamous epithelium, many layers of flat cells at the surface. So here is a slide of the epidermis. At the very bottom, of course, is where the basement membrane would be, connecting the epidermis to the dermis. And so it is stratified squamous epithelium and, of course, avascular, because all epithelial tissue is avascular. The cells that divide the reproductive layer for the epidermis is the bottommost layer of cells, the single layer of cells. Referred to as stratum basale. They are well nourished because they are near the blood vessels and capillaries that are in the dermis, located near the epidermis. And as I said, this is where the cells are that do the dividing to produce new cells for the epidermis, in that one single layer of cells. All right, stratum basale again at the very bottom. And when stratum basale produces a new cell, that cell is deposited above the stratum basale layer, which then pushes the cells above that up and the cells above that up and so on, so that slowly over time the cells will migrate through all the layers of the epidermis. Now, during this process, the cells undergo a process called keratinization. Basically, they over time fill up with this protein called keratin, very tough, fibrous protein that helps to make the cells tough and hold them together, but also causes them to die. And these cells, the majority of cells in the epidermis, are known as keratinocytes. So the epithelial cells are also known as keratinocytes. All right, so directly superficial to the stratum basale is stratum spinosum. Stratum spinosum is made up of a few layers of cells, four, five, six. Cells here are more pointy in shape, more spiny, as it were, spinosum spiny. And this is because they're trying to form tight junctions and connections between cells to help hold them together and strengthen the epidermis. Above that is stratum granulosum. Stratum granulosum, a few layers of cells. Here the cells are still alive, but they're now starting to die and degrade. They also release a waterproofing substance to help prevent water loss. Then, superficial to that is stratum lucidum. Stratum lucidum, a thin layer that's actually normally somewhat transparent, but there's a dye being used in that slide. Stratum lucidum is only present in thick skin, so you only see it in thick skin. And then superficial to that is stratum corneum. Stratum corneum found in all skin, but it's thicker in thick skin. Stratum corneum, the cells are completely dead, and they are basically big bags of keratin. They've lost their nucleus, they've lost their organelles. All they have pretty much is the cell membrane and lots of keratin protein. Cells, as we know, are super flat, aka squamous, and their sizes may vary a bit, but that's pretty much it for them. And apoptosis, as I'm sure you remember, is the process of programmed cell death. So as the keratinocytes travel through the layers of the epidermis, they are undergoing apoptosis, and this is a desired thing to occur. It also means that anytime you touch somebody and touch their skin, you are touching a dead part of their body. All right, thick skin and thin skin. Where do we find thick skin in the body? And also, how is thick skin different from thin skin? Well, hope you said that thick skin is found in the soles of the feet and the palms of the hands. That's right, that is where thick skin is found, and the only places thick skin is found. Everywhere else is thin skin. So most of the skin of our body is thin skin. Other characteristics of thick skin possesses stratum lucidum. Thick skin has no hair follicles, and because of that, it has no sebaceous glands. So thick skin lacks hair and oil glands. And of course, super thick stratum corneum. In stratum corneum. Calluses. Calluses can develop on thin or thick skin. And what happens is when an area that's experiencing a lot of regular friction or use, basically the cells in the stratum basale begin dividing more rapidly, leading to a thickening of the stratum corneum. So calluses are just thicker stratum corneums. And of course, as we know, it's avascular, which is why little kids have so much fun stabbing their calluses and sticking stick pins through them and suffering no consequences adversely from it. All right, besides keratinocytes, the epithelial cells, there are a few other cells found in the epidermis. One example is melanocytes. Melanocytes are the pigment cells. They produce the pigment melanin, and they are found on the deepest layer. They're found on stratum basale. And then they have little processes that go up into stratum spinosum, and there they deposit the pigment granules into the keratinocytes. The keratinocytes end up having melanin added to them to make them have the darker color that the person's skin is. And this is a good thing because this pigment melanin absorbs UV radiation. And so it helps to protect the underlying living cells from that mutagenic damaging consequences of UV exposure. That's a good thing. And the darker your skin is, the better protected you are from UV light. Another thing that can happen to melanocytes is they could experience some mutations and begin growing somewhat uncontrollably and form a benign tumor that we know as a mole. So mole used to be a melanocyte, but it got mutations in its DNA and started reproducing much too rapidly. All right, skin color. Skin color is the effect of genetic environmental and physiological factors. Genetics can affect how much melanin is produced, environmental factors such as how much sun exposure you're getting, or if you're using sun lamps or x-rays, not advised. Sun skin color can also be a diagnostic tool. So cyanotic, if the skin is somewhat bluish, or the mucous membranes around, say, the lips are bluish, then this could be a sign of lack of oxygen to a part of the body. A jaundice, if the skin becomes abnormal yellowish color, and especially if the whites of the eyes also become sort of yellowish, that could be a sign of liver disease. Arrhythmia. Arrhythmia is redness of the skin. It can be caused by an injury, by inflammation, or by allergic reactions. Pallor. Pallor, a paleness of the skin, could be caused by shock or anemia. All right, the dermis. The dermis is deep to the epidermis. It is a thick, thick layer, and it helps to bind the epidermis to underlying tissues, as well as housing many, many important structures. So the dermis, at the superficial end of the dermis, it has all these little heels and bumps, as it were, going up and down. These are referred to as the dermal papillae. They are right at the interface between the dermis and the epidermis, and it sort of intercalates, interlocks with the epidermis, increasing surface area between the dermis and epidermis, and that strengthens the connection between those two layers of the skin, helping to prevent them from separating, which is very important. We do not want this epidermis to separate from the dermis. And there are particularly deep ones in thick skin, and that's what gives us fingerprints. So fingerprints are actually formed from a very large dermal papillae interlocking with the epidermis. So within the dermal papillae are lots and lots of blood capillaries. Very important because it's bringing nutrients to the epidermis as well as carrying heat to the surface of the skin. What is one of the main tissues in the dermis? Simple squamous, dense connective, stratified adipose. I hope you chose dense connective tissue. So the two main tissues in the dermis is areolar connective tissue with its collagen and elastic fibers, and dense connective tissue with lots of collagen fibers, giving the dermis a lot of strength and elasticity, allowing it to be able to be stretched as well as to resist stretching forces. We find things within the dermis such as sensory receptors, tactile corpuscles, laminated corpuscles for sense of touch. There's erector pili muscles that connect the hair follicles to right below the epidermis. Erector pili muscles are smooth muscle tissue structures. Every hair follicle has one, and they basically are what causes goosebumps. Sebaceous glands, oil glands associated with hair follicles, Merkin glands for sweat production. And then we got the subcutaneous layer. Subcutaneous layer is not part of the skin. Subcutaneous layer, though, is deep to the skin, and it's composed primarily of, is it stratified, dense, simple squamous, or adipose? It is adipose. Subcutaneous layer is primarily adipose or fatty tissue. It is got some areolar connective tissue as well. It is insulation. It prevents heat loss, so it helps us not lose heat. And it's also shock absorber. We can take a strike and not necessarily have underlying tissues damaged. And that is it for this part of